Hello, everyone. I want to start by saying thank you all for joining us via Zoom for this afternoon. Before we get started, I'd like to ask everyone to keep their microphones on mute if possible. That would be really helpful. The session is being recorded, so that for future, anyone who wasn't able to make this meeting or for future viewing, this will be available for people. Any questions you have can be submitted via the chat feature, so you can either like private message me and Katie, or you can just put it in for everyone and we can get to it at the end of the session. So with all that boring info aside, hello everyone, my name is Denzin Yantin. I'm an international student from India, and I'm also the first person in my family to study in America in college. So that makes me in HWS a first generation student. I'm a double major in English and Asian studies. So I'm also extremely active in the community. So some of the activities I'm a part of are like secretary for the Hobart student government. I was the treasurer for the International Student Association up till last 2 weeks ago, actually. I'm also a campus relations officer in campus activities board, we also call it CAB, shorten it. And I'm in a lot of like culture or minority focused diversity clubs, such as Pride, South Asian Student Association, Asian Student Union. And I'm in a lot of like volunteering experience, such as serving as a mentor in a Big Brother Big Sister, and also the organizing committee of the Day of Service. So joining me today in the session is Professor Richard Salter, who you've just heard in talking about the wonderful weather, my advisor in history professor, Professor Lisa Yoshikawa, who's joining us, and senior Katie Mandaru, 2021. Katie, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. My name's Katie Mandarano. I'm a William Smith senior. I'm from the Finger Lakes area, near Rochester, a town called York. I'm a double major here in political science and religious studies, and a member of the Pi Sigma National Honor Society in political science. I'm a midfielder on the Heron soccer team here. I also studied abroad my junior year in Stockholm Spring, so I can speak to a little bit about the abroad program they offer here. And then also post-graduation, I'm planning on going to the University of Maryland to pursue a law degree in their cybersecurity and crisis management program. Like Tendon said, we are here with Professor Salter, and I've taken two of his classes. One was a religious studies seminar where we conduct a semester-long research paper of our choice. Just to talk a little bit about my research paper, I looked at the role of religiosity and team athletic success. So I looked at if there was a relationship or trend at the Division III level of collegiate athletics in the US to see if there was a disproportionate amount of strictly religious schools succeeding there, and overall titles, respective leagues, and NCAA appearances.
Thank you, Katie. I'd also like to now introduce my advisor, Professor Yoshikawa. I've taken 5 classes with her in my short stint at HWS. Actually, currently I'm taking 2 classes with her. One is A World of Civilized Barbarians, in which we're exploring like how the Japanese Tokugawa shogunate, as well as the Manchu Qing dynasty, rose to prominence, and how that sort of challenges the Sinocentric world order that places China in the center, surrounded by barbarians. I'm also taking my second class with her, which is an independent study. So that's something you can take like from your sophomore year onwards, where we are working on research on Japanese tourism, you know, folks, because my team consists of me and 2 other students and Professor Yoshikawa's advisor. We actually won an Asia Network research grant to research in Japan about a topic of our choice. And we are exploring how Japanese tourism can be used to uncode or decode the Japanese national identity. And I look forward to going to Tokyo when, you know, the pandemic subsides with Professor Yoshikawa and my team to discover more about the Japanese tourism. Professor Yoshikawa, can you tell us a bit about your background? And can you tell us about the history curriculum? And what options do students have within the major or minor if they choose to take so?
Sure. Thank you, Tenzin, and thank you, Katie. So as you can tell from what Tenzin said, I teach Asian history. I'm trained as a historian of modern Japan, but I teach Asia. So we just came from class, Tenzin and I came from a class where we were talking about Russian imperialism expansion into Northern Pacific, right? So that's how big Asia is. So I teach that at the colleges. Which is just one piece of the large history faculty and curriculum we have here at the colleges. You can learn about, I think it's all continents except for Antarctica and Australia, depending on how you count your continents. We have specialists in all others. So you can, you know, spatially, geographically, you can take classes, history classes, on all of those areas, and temporally too, because history is really about how humanity changes over time, right? So we encourage students to study not just various parts of the world, but various time periods, right, in those parts of the world. So a little bit about the history curriculum and major. There's a lot of freedom for our majors. It's a 10 course major, which means you take 10 courses to complete the major. And we encourage students to take broader courses. So, you know, long time span covering hundreds of years, right? Which is a great introduction to think about how things change over time. And students also pick what they're interested in. So it's a theme. You know, if you're interested in a time period, if you're interested in a geographic area, you know, some of the students pick themes, like some people like to learn about wars. So they pick several courses on that to complete the major. So there's quite a bit of freedom, you know, taking a seminar here and there, electives, to learn about various time periods in various places in the world.
Thank you, Professor. So as I've said, I've taken two classes with Professor Salter. Professor Salter, can you tell us a bit about yourself and the religious studies curriculum and what options the students have within the major and minor?
Yeah, sure. So my name is Richard Salter. I've been at the colleges for about 20 years now, and I came here after getting my degree at the University of Chicago. I was an undergraduate at Hobart and William Smith and graduated in 86, so I've been in and around Geneva for a very long time. I was a political science major as a student, but then went on to study religious studies. And I got very interested in the Caribbean because after graduating, I went into the Peace Corps and was sent into the Eastern Caribbean. And so that's where my specialization first started. Here I teach the Christianity courses, and that means everything that's, the title of the position is Global Christianity. So it's a huge, huge, huge thing. It involves the entire globe and all history for the last 2000 years. So within that very, very broad area, most of my courses have to do either with the relationship of Christianity and culture, especially contemporary culture, or also I will do classes on theories of studying religion or the methods that are used for studying religion. And those are kind of courses that teach a toolkit. You know, what is it that we can use to find out about the way that religion affects the world that we live in, and also the way that religion is affected by the worlds that we live in. Some of the other things I've done here on campus, I've been involved with some study abroad. I've taken students to Argentina a few times, and also have been involved with some extracurricular things like the Human Rights and Genocide Symposium, and also with something called the March, where some of us combine with Nazareth College and take students every other year to Germany and Poland on a trip that looks at sites that were important for the Holocaust, including some of the bigger death camps. And so we do that every other year. The religious studies major is a very flexible major also. We have some people who will major just in religious studies, but a lot of people will major in religious studies and something else. It's very easy to combine with other fields. You can imagine how, for example, history and religion are very closely intertwined at certain periods, so it creates a natural fit. Currently have number of students who are double majors in political science and religion. Katie, I know you've got interest in those areas. It's an understudied area that is coming into prominence as people look at the way that political groups and religious groups share some qualities and overlap. I'm actually cross-listed in Latin American studies, but also in international relations because I teach also courses on nationalism, and some of the important roots of nationalism are found in religious movements. It's a 10-course major, and we do allow some courses to come from outside of the department because there are other places on campus where you can also take some courses that have to do with religion and that contribute to our major. So we often get students who take, I don't know, Greek and Roman religions in the classics department, and we count that. I guess I'll stop there. We can go on if people have more questions about that, but it's really, I think the distinctive thing or the fun thing about the college is the way where these different majors can actually intersect and combine. And so you can find your own way through and see how the connections start to make sense as you're doing it.
Thank you so much for all the wonderful information, Professor Salto. Professor Yoshikawa, what are some of the jobs and internships that you have seen students in the humanities pursue?
I think that's a great question. I think humanities in general teach you really basic skills really well. So reading critically, right, carefully, right, analyzing material, doing research, you know, writing succinctly, which means that, I have better information for history majors, but they land all sorts of internships and jobs across the board. So if you go to the history department website, you can actually see a list there of the kinds of jobs that our graduates have landed or internships that our students have taken. But, you know, you can go from investment banking, you know, place like, I don't know if I'm allowed to say names of banking, but you know, investment banking and Wall Street, right? That kind of jobs, to media journalism, you know, more history, like maybe museum, working in museum. We have a lot of students want to be teachers and become teachers. Going into law and law school is also we see among their students. And these are same for both jobs and internships. So there's a lot of different opportunity because I think humanities give you a lot of these basic skills that not everybody really has, but is really coveted in any of these fields.
Professor Salter, could you tell us a little bit about the abroad program you lead here and what else where else students study abroad and what type of unique coursework or experiences they can take advantage of on those specific programs?
Yeah, well, I'll just start with the two that I know the best, the Argentina program and then the March that I already mentioned. And they're two very different programs. The Argentina program is a semester-long program. It goes also every other year. And it's an immersion program. You don't need fluency in Spanish to go. You only need, I think, one or two semesters. So often people qualify with just what they've taken in high school. But you go down there and you're placed with a family and you live with that family. There's a faculty director from Hobart and William Smith, but all of the teaching, well, let's say all the students will take at least one course, sometimes two courses from that HWS faculty member, but all the other courses, the language courses and at least one other culture course is taught by Argentine professors. And we go to Mendoza, which is in the west of Argentina. So out in the wine region where the Andes rise up to, you know, 15 and 20,000 feet, only about 150, 200 miles from the coast in Chile. And so there are a lot of great excursions that we take to see different places. Ended up going to Santiago to see the capital of another country, which is quite close. Take excursions down to Patagonia, in order to see some of the mountains down there and the lakes and the beautiful areas, see the differences of culture down there, spend some time. I don't know, we've gone to the north sometimes, to the border of Brazil and Uruguay, Paraguay, and Argentina. And so I haven't led that in a couple of years because other faculty members have put in for it, but it's an ongoing program. And of course it had to be canceled because of COVID, but I think it'll be taken up again. And then the March program is kind of on the opposite end of the program. That's a short-term program. It's only 2 weeks. It's something that we offer in combination with Nazareth. And it's really intense, deep dive into a single thematic issue, which is the Holocaust. And we learn it by going to places, speaking with experts. And actually, we've been fortunate. I've done it, I think this will be my fourth time, but I think every single time it's gone, we've also been fortunate to travel with survivors who also tell us about their experiences. So it's a really rich, rich, rich experience. And that's just a 2-week program. Through global education, there are programs that go all over the place. So I don't know, Lisa, maybe because you just mentioned your class having to do with Russia, I've got, you know, there are programs in Russia. There have been programs over the years, short-term summer programs to Siberia, but there are also programs to New Zealand. And there are programs to Sevilla in Spain if people want an immersion program. There have been programs, there are programs, I think, to South Africa. And all of these programs are slightly different. So you can really find something that fits what you want to do. So for example, students who want to go to a place like Jordan or Morocco, they go through the Center for Global Education, but they don't go with other Hobart and William Smith students, because there's usually only one or two students a year who want to go to those places. But they go through Global Education and another international organization, get placed with a family and take classes at a school in that place, get all their language training. And then for people who are interested in programs that come just from Hobart and William Smith, they're the ones like I described in Argentina. And there are those that go all over Galway, Ireland,
Vietnam.
So really the sky's the limit. We had exchange programs also, Yonsei University in Korea, there's Hong Kong, any number of possibilities.
Thank you so much for that, Professor Salter. Professor Yoshikawa, what are some of the majors or minors that you have noticed students bear with, like certain majors like religious studies, history, or philosophy even?
Yeah, as Professor Salter said earlier, I think they actually pair well with each other, right? I've had students who did, well, right now I have a student who doing history and philosophy, and I've had others doing history and religious studies, right? I think generally because history and most humanities are not too hierarchical majors. And by that, I mean, you don't need to take courses in a certain order, right? For sciences, like you have to take the basic science and then you write for a reason, right? But for you know, history, you can just jump in if you want to into a 200 level course, right? You can do that. So that gives a little bit of a flexibility. So it's easy to pair with a little bit more rigid majors and minors. Many of my students that I have study international relations, Asian studies, environmental studies. Those are all kind of crossing with my interests. So I guess a lot of those students. But you know, there's students in history doing sciences too, like geoscience, you know, mathematics, biology, which are more time intensive, because you have labs and that kind of stuff, but it's quite easy to pair with something like history, you know, 10 course major, where you can take courses, not randomly, but you know, it's not a strict order.
Thank you, Professor. I think we have some audience questions if we want to get to those before the time's out.
We had one question come in that might be a little bit more English specific, but I wasn't sure anyone on the call would have some knowledge. One student wanted to know about creative writing and working with Fell or the Seneca Review. Does anyone? I also sent them a link, but I wasn't sure if anyone had any experience or knowledge.
Yeah, I can actually answer that question because I'm double majoring in English as well. So, and I'm also like the editor for Tell, which is our HWS literary magazine, for those who don't know. So in terms of like creative writing courses, I think HWS is one of the best colleges actually for creative writing. And why I say that is because, like, for those who don't know, we have a special program in HWS called the Trias Writers. Well, like, it's just a special grant reserved to get college like poets or like short story fiction writers to come and live in HWS for 1 year. And then they teach courses for that period of 1 year. So it's a very competitive program, but it's also like one of the most, like, you work very closely with them and you get to learn and improve your art a lot. I've also taken courses with the creative writing faculty members here, and I definitely strongly recommend each and every one of them. In terms of being active in the extracurricular side, so that's like either Tell or like HWS Herald, which is our newspaper, it's actually pretty easy. You just need to either show up to the meetings that are usually like publicized through the weekly email that's sent out, or even just like email or just reach out to one member that you know is in there. Like, for example, the way I got into Tell is I talked to one of my teaching assistants who actually was an editor for Tell as well. And she was like, yeah, Tenzin, sure, join us. Because they advertise on Instagram, but I don't have social media. So I wasn't able to find out how to join the meeting. So it's pretty friendly and open for those who are really interested in it. I definitely recommend.
Great, thank you. I just got another question. What are the research opportunities for history majors?
There's a lot. So if you take a seminar, many of the seminars are more upper level classes. Many of them do research projects in the course, which is more guided. So if you're new to research, that's a good way to get started. Oftentimes professors guide you through how to do a research project, right? So for one of my courses, I teach my students how to write a grant proposal. So it's actually even before research, right? How do you ask for money to start doing research, right? So we take 15 weeks to try to learn that, right? If you already have ideas about what research you want to do, then you can always do independent studies, usually, as Tenzin said earlier, recommended for sophomores and above, right? And work with professors you want to work with. Maybe you've taken a class with a professor and you can do research with them. Some professors in the history department hire students to be research assistants. They tend to be Americanists because most students can work in English, but you will have, some people might have those kind of opportunities too. So then there's honors, which is a long year long research project that you do usually in your senior year, which is a much bigger project that if you are successful, there's all these different stages to this, you will graduate with honors. So there's many, many different opportunities. And as Tenzin and I and two other students are doing, we also wrote out for a grant. We actually got money to go to Japan to do this research. So now we're doing independent research, sort of a pre-research, right, I guess, Tenzin, that we're doing. So we can actually go do research in Tokyo, hopefully when COVID is over.
Just add in that, you know, a lot of the majors have capstone experiences that absolutely integrate doing research. And many majors also have methodology courses where earlier on you go through a lot of the steps of how to do research as well. And I just want to put a plug for the honors program. I'm actually working with someone right now who is doing a history and religious studies honors program. So I'm co-advising with someone in history. It's a great and really unique program at Hobart and William Smith that has been around since, I think, the 40s in almost unchanged form. It's really rigorous, but really good.
Does anyone else have any questions they want to ask? One looks like it came in the chat. What would be the workload for a history and religious studies major? Professor Salter and Professor Yoshikawa, you guys can go back and forth if you want to answer this one.
Well, I would say it should be hard and challenging, and it should push you beyond the limits that you're comfortable with. Otherwise, you're not getting what you pay for a college, and you could just do it on your own. So I would say we average, probably 7 books per semester in religious studies, sometimes a little bit more, sometimes a little bit less. It depends on the length of the book and the kind of material. Most of the work that we're doing and the workload is reading, and then that's punctuated with writing. And as Professor Yoshikawa said, these are the skills of the humanities: reading, writing, interpreting, speaking, discussing. And I kind of like to think about it this way, and this is a real unadulterated plug for the humanities, even for the scientists who are out there, take some humanities courses, because it's kind of like if you're really a high level athlete, it's great. You can train in that specialty, train in that specialty, train in that specialty. But at the same time, you want the whole rest of your body to be healthy. And if you're a runner, for example, and your knee goes out, you want to be able to swim also, right? You want to be able to do all of these things. So whereas some of the courses of study, let's say in the sciences, might train you kind of narrowly, which is very useful for jobs. In the humanities, you're actually kind of learning how to be an athlete in general. All these basic skills that 15 years from now, when the world doesn't look anything like it looks like now, and we've got something else that has come and taken the place of social media, you'll have the flexibility and the skills of knowing how to do these shifts. And that comes from this kind of basic hard work of reading, writing, talking, interpreting, analyzing.
Yeah, a lot of the work doesn't necessarily have to be the reading work, right? There's reading work, there's writing work and all that. But also, I think what I want to add is there's also a lot of thinking work that goes on, right? Thinking work, humanity is about humanity, right? I mean, that might seem like an obvious thing to say, but we think about humanity, why we do what we do, why we have done what we have done. And what does that mean for us? And what does it say about humanity, right? So a lot of the times, reading and writing is just sort of a tool, technology, right? That we're using to try to get to those questions where we're reading and writing and then thinking, right? So it's all sorts of different kinds of work we do.
I'm gonna give another quick example. Any student who's going into pre-health or pre-med, you should take a course in the humanities. We've got one in religious studies on death and dying. And as a human being, if you're going into health, you also have to think about what sickness is. And you also have to think about what dying means. And it's not comfortable, but the very best doctors, physicians, nurse practitioners, nurses, physical therapists, they're able to understand who their patients are because they're able to understand something of these broader things. And not just what it means in one place, but what it means in another place and in a different culture and maybe in another language and all of this stuff. So you got a real humanities crowd today. So we're pushing it hard, but...
Yeah, so I just got a question from someone who's like wondering about like the travel restrictions and not being able to attend events for the admitted students and what is like the general HWS vibe. I would say like as soon as you enter here, you'll find out that it's a very, like HWS is a small college, and for better or worse, that's like how you use it depends on you. So like, for example, it's very easy to make friends here because you kind of know everyone just like from the classes or the activities, especially if you're active in the community. And also, like, events are almost always open to everyone. Like, there's never been events where it's just like for a certain group of students. So it's pretty inclusionary. I would say, like, it's definitely a homely sort of vibe. You know, like, it feels like a second home, like being at HWS, because you bond with those same like group of friends or people that you know, or professors even, like Professor Yoshikawa. Like, I've had her almost every semester now, and it's like learning experience for me. So I would say it's definitely a place where it feels very easy to make friends and, you know, get connections with people. But also, like, if you want to be even more active and more, if you want to participate more, it's really simple to do so, as long as you put in the effort to do so.
So another question from the chat is for you, Tenzin. Why did you choose HWS?
Why did I choose HWS? I guess I would say for its small size is one of the big factors, because I came from a small high school and I really enjoyed knowing everybody, like the faculty members and also like the staff. But of course, there's a lot of colleges in America that has a small size. So like, why in specific HWS? I think one was definitely like the academic programs offered were really in my interest, like the 3S program, as I mentioned, because I'm a creative writer, I really wanted to take part in a unique program like that, where I get to spend a year with acclaimed authors or poets and learn from them directly. It was also, as I said earlier before, I'm really in a lot of like community activities. And the reason is because I love just being an active member of community, learning what everyone's up to, you know, if anything's like important, like what's the social matters that are present. I think HWS is really known for its like how active the community members are in terms of like the day of service is the yearly or twice a year event where we do volunteer work for the local Geneva community. And it's just where we give back to the people, to the community, because we live in it. So I think, yeah, I was just really impressed by the small size, but also like how active the small member people are. Like, as I like to say, it's a small place, but a big voice. That's how I feel in HWS. And I think if you're someone who appreciates that, it's a wonderful experience.
Okay, so I think we have time for one more question. This one's for me. How has HWS prepared you for law school? I would say HWS does a really good job of preparing people for law school. And I know friends who are going on to medical school, they also have awesome networks that they can reach out to. But for law school specifically, there's a pre-law advisor on campus that you can ask questions to about the whole process. We have the Career Services Building where they really help you with your application. I was able to take my LSAT in a room reserved for me on campus. There's someone here specifically for personal statements, which is something you have to submit with your application. They can help you out with interviews, going through mock interviews, stuff like that. So they're really helpful preparing you in that way. In terms of the criteria, I think the majors here prepare you really well for law school. Just the analyzing, the writing, the reading, the workload that you have here, I think would really help someone interested in that career field. So that was all the time we have for today. Thank you guys for joining us. If you have further questions or you'd like to get in touch with one of us later in the decision-making process, we've dropped all our emails in the chat for you, or the Office of Admissions can always connect us as well. So thank you so much and best of luck as you guys make your final decisions.